Six Music.
Liz Kershaw's Legend in Your Own Lunchtime.
So, Stockholm, so you've started on this Round the World and then Round Australia tour already?
Yeah, you bet. We've South America, Brazil, United States, Canada, Europe, and then, of course, Interpol, a couple of London dates, and then we just keep on going until we finally drag our little Aussie sunburned bodies back to Australia by the end of the year.
I don't think that, and I include myself in this, I don't think most people in Pomland, as you call it, just appreciate how massive you are as a band and how long you've been going. So you got together in 1970 in its embryonic stage. You released your first album in 1978. You've had 14 full albums. I think it's because, you know what, Peter, I think when you were sort of having international hits, we were being bombarded with Kylie and Jason.
It's true.
It is.
Yeah, look, it's a funny thing, isn't it, Liz? And yeah, and I mean, I think we're the kind of band that sort of drifted in and out of public consciousness, but luckily we've always stayed in music fan consciousness, and I guess that's always been pretty important to us. We wish Kylie every success, but you're right, she did tend to take your attention one way or the other.
I mean, we did get to hear about In Excess, and then if you'd asked me in a pop quiz, you know, name Australian bands, I would have been pretty stuck until you came along with your big Pom Smash, Beds Are Burning, and then we did know about you.
Yeah, and look, we'd spent some time, I mean, we recorded two albums in England. We did a record with Glyn Johns, very famous English producer who saw us in Sydney and wanted to record us, and we went and recorded with him in the early 80s, and then again we did an album called 1098, 7654321 in London, but we couldn't get anyone interested in it really much in England. So we went back home, we played the pubs, that album came out, it was very successful for us, and then we went into the American college circuit effectively. I mean, you know, when you're a musician, a working musician, you end up going to the places where people are putting up their hands and saying, can we have a listen? And it's nice to know that we can come back into London and do a good show and that people will come. But yeah, it's been a little bit low profile for us there. Anyway, that's about to change, huh?
Yeah, of course. And we all know you now. And we're so pleased to have you on the show. Now, back to the single, Beds Are Burning. I got it at the time that it was about, you know, the environment and the earth heating up. Lots of my friends thought it was about hot sex, but I didn't. So,
we had a really interesting trip as a band. We went somewhere that no other Aussie rock bands really had gone before, which is right out into the middle of the country, right out into the desert. We played to Aboriginal communities out there. We took an Aboriginal band with us. And so that song is as much about the conditions that those people had faced when, as it were, the English first arrived, because, as you know, we started life in the modern Australia as an English colony.
And Scottish.
A lot of our...
And Welsh. And Irish.
Okay, well, you're getting off lightly then.
No, I'm just spreading the guilt.
I think the thing is that a lot of music doesn't have words with meaning, you know, and that's fine. It has its place. You know, if you like, it's oral wallpaper, and it's got a role to play, but we're so gnarly and kind of solid on the things that we do give us stuff about that we tend to write about them as well. And sometimes that means you're misunderstood. Sometimes it puts people off, but we can't help it. That's the way we are. We're just ornery.
But you've taken that a step further, your concerns, the things that you campaign for, because you actually became an MP in 2004 in the Australian Parliament. And then when the Labour Party formed a government, you were Minister of the Environment. Crikey.
Yeah, I know. And then I was Minister for Education as well, so for my sins.
Did you wear a suit and tie?
Yeah, not always. Sometimes I did, sometimes I didn't. I mean, you know the thing about that, Liz? You could do it one or two ways. You could essentially go into that place and trade on who you were and how you were and essentially be kind of like fodder, if you like, for a lot of the popular press and, you know, constantly kind of play up what you've done. But I took another route. You know, I took it seriously. I believed in the job. I was, I guess, optimistic enough to believe that, you know, we could make a difference. I think we did. And I wasn't prepared to essentially use Midnight Oil, which is a pretty well-known band in Australia, as my kind of calling card into the parliament. I mean, people knew who I was, but I was content to be a part of that government and try and get some stuff done. And we had a very good woman prime minister and who I worked very closely with, and we just rolled up our sleeves and got on with it.
Well, good for you, because you know what gets me down is when I've been playing records for 30 years, but when I express a political opinion away from this job. I do get abuse like, oh, stick to what you can do, get back to playing records. And some people have the perception that if you're really into music, you must be an airhead and you can't have any political views or make a difference. What do you say to those people?
You've got to have a view. And I think that whilst there's a place for doing both things in the world, we're kind of people who in our lives are going to be facing up to stuff which requires political decisions. And you can whinge about governments, but sometimes you've got to change them. And I'm a strong believer in political activism, strong believer in getting out and standing up for what you believe in. I think that's how history has been made over thousands of years. Not always for the better, but better one step forward than two steps back.
Well, music does have a history of its own of making a political point. And let's have that big hit in the UK. I think it was 1989. Midnight Oil, Beds Are Burning.
Out where the river broke, the bloodwood and the desert oak, holding wrecks and boiling diesels, steam at 45 degrees. The time has
Midnight Oil, Beds Are Burning, and we're talking to Peter Garrett of Midnight Oil. So we've just been discussing your political activism. If you were in charge for a day, Peter, what needs doing then?
Liz, thank you for that question. Well, you know, the thing is, I spent time as an environmental activist before I went into politics, and Midnight Oil had done a number of different environment actions. And I guess the obvious one for me is just to pull down rapidly the amount of pollution that's going to the atmosphere, get out of coal, get out of producing a lot of greenhouse emissions, and make sure we keep the planet a slightly safe and habitable place, not only for ourselves but for our kids. That'll be the most important one by a long way.
I'm just going to be devil's advocate now. It's a question that's asked a lot. It's not personal to you, but when you get big rock stars campaigning to save the planet and then they embark on a world tour with jets and trucks and lighting rigs and all the people travelling up and down to get to their gigs as well, you know, it says in this press release about the tour that you're going to offset your carbon footprint, and some people might think, baloney. I mean, convince me. How do you make sure that you're not damaging the planet by getting all your trucks and planes on the road?
Well, I think, like everybody else, when it comes to getting from A to B, we'll take the transport that's available for us. If there were more electric cars, I'm sure we'd choose them, and buses and likewise. But it's a serious question. It's a good one. We made sure that we offset the emissions across the tour. And we'll probably do it, actually, by working with people in Timor who are planting out some of their farms and areas to get more productivity in it. And that's one way we do it. And obviously we do it through the airline schemes as well. Offsetting is one of the few options that we currently have nowadays. And I think my answer to the question in a bigger way was, how is it that business and global politics have failed us so poorly, knowing that climate change is coming upon us, knowing that Antarctic ice sheets are starting to break away, knowing that we're starting to get incredibly hot summers, by not facilitating that big changes to a low energy future with real energy efficient technologies, the solar, the wind, the electric cars, the good long life batteries, the insulation you need, energy efficiency, all that stuff that can make a difference, employ people, keep the economy going and hold the temperatures down. I mean, give us those options, and that's what the system needs to do.
Well, if I were in charge, I'd say, let's stop shifting loads of crap that we don't need halfway around the world on giant tankers, oil-based products that just end up in the sea. I'm not talking about your albums from Australia, by the way, Peter.
No, I very much agree with you. What's been interesting on the tour, actually, is even coming out of South America and the States, we've been as strong about the things that we've always believed in as before. We're playing a lot of the songs from different albums. We're throwing ourselves into the business of making sure the performance and connection with audiences. That's what you have to do as a musician. You're a troubadour. But we're also connecting with the activist groups and the people that are taking it up to the planet destroyers and these people who are too short-sighted and greedy and ignorant to realise that the health of the global community is at stake. And it's been amazing to see that response. Honestly, it's been very humbling.
You've also at the moment, you've got your complete vinyl collection box set out and the full tank CD box set. And the full tank, it's something familiar to Midnight Oil fans, and you actually have a replica of a tank on stage. What's that all about?
Yeah, well, the water tank itself, it's these old water tanks. It's still all around Australia. They collect rainwater off the roofs and they're made out of corrugated iron. Rob Hurst, our drummer, has used one for kind of a percussion element for many years when we've toured. I think the thing about the band, Liz, is that we really drew our inspiration from the place that we grew up in. Of course, we had bands that we liked and musical heroes, whether it was The Clash or, you know, The Who or The Doors or The Shins or whoever it might have been. At the same time, the business of our Australianness, it wasn't like we were wearing it like the cricket team, but it just seemed to be the thing that made us tick. And I think that's in a lot of the music that we've made, even music that people don't know. If you listen to the collected set, you'll hear a reflection of 30 years of creativity, which is partly about the place that we were in, but it's also partly about trying to craft good songs and have performances that work for us.
Well, people have missed now the 4th of July show that you did at London Hammersmith, Aventim Apollo, but they can go Sunday the 23rd to see you at the same venue, and it sounds like they're in for a treat. It's been really good to talk to you. You sound like a fascinating bloke. Do come and see us live and direct in the BBC sometime, won't you?
Yeah, look, I'd love to do that. Thanks for having us on, Liz. All the best.
Can you just pick one song from your set that you're doing from your 14 albums and your 40 years, if I dare mention it. Just pick one song that gets the whole joint jumping.
Well, that's a nice question and a hard call. I'll go for Blue Sky Mine. That's the one that just seems to be lifting the roof a little bit as we go.
Okay, well, let's lift the roof here now. Peter Garrett from Midnight Oil in Stockholm. Thanks for talking to me today, and we'll see you in London. Thanks, Peter.
Okay, no worries, Liz. All the best. Bye.
Sorry if you had to guess who that was, because producer Adam chopped off my introduction. Sorry. It was Peter Garrett, of course, from Midnight Oil. What an interesting and fascinating and accomplished man. You might have seen Midnight Oil this week in London. If you miss them, your chance comes again on the 23rd of July at the Hammersmith Apollo. Right.